opportunity of inviting and welcoming all the participants to the 10th classroom of EMW Gen Next series to 2021. Tonight we are going to have P. Kavita Balakrishnan as our guest speaker, teacher speaker. We have Mr. Thankachan, Mr. Pushpagupta, the person behind the entire classroom series. May I now request Subhangi to please introduce herself.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Subhangi. I'm a second year law student in National Law University, Patiala, that is in Punjab. And I've been attending these series regularly. I've been learning a lot of things. I suddenly developed a very unique interest in mediation. Recently, I wrote an article also. These series are very helpful. And in these times of lockdown, I think it's very important that students indulge in new activities, that students indulge in these series. And without further ado, I would love to hand over to Rajiv, sir.
Thank you so much, Subhangi. Introduce our teacher speaker for today's classroom, P. Kavita Balakrishnan. She was enrolled as an advocate in 1996, practicing on the civil and the criminal side in the state of Tamil Nadu. Madam Balakrishnan is a coordinator in publication of law books. She had published books on land acquisition, caveat authored by Mr. K.P. Palaniappan, former special government pleader, High Court at Madras, authored the books, Laws Relating to Tamil Nadu Housing Board. Madam Balakrishnan is a mediator since 2008. She was enrolled as a mediator on the panel of Tamil Nadu Mediation Center, on panel of the High Court, Family Court, District Court, Chennai, and labor court. She had occasion of handling several sensitive court-referred mediations and private cases, including corporate and commercial cases too. As a mediator trainer with Supreme Court of India's Mediation and Conciliation Project Committee, Madam Balakrishnan has conducted mediation training programs for lawyers and judges in Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. She had also conducted workshops in college and schools, creating awareness on ADR with the Society for Alternative Dispute Resolution. She is a qualified online mediator with the ADR-ODR International. She has done advanced training in commercial, jointly conducted by the Bangalore International Mediation, Arbitration and Conciliation Center in collaboration with the Faculty of Law, Jain, deemed to be the University of Bangalore. Madam Balakrishnan is presently serving as the Joint Secretary of Mediators India, President for Alternate Dispute Resolutions, President Tamil Nadu Mediators and Conciliators Association, and she is a Secretary to the Progressive Law Society. She is also Founder Ambassador of Mediation and a renowned trainer and fellowship of a fellow of KFCRI, that is COVIS Foundation for VDR. Over to you, Madam Push, now.
Sir, over to Ma'am Kavita. Kavita ji, please, floor is with you. For you, with your students. Thank you, Rajesh ji.
Thank you.
Thank you for that wonderful introduction. And thank you, Push, for this organizing this event and just thinking about me. Thank you. Here today, we are just on the topic of online mediation. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are. Perfectly.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, madam, you are audible.
Fine. Online mediation is, initially, we'll start with the basic of what is online mediation. We all know what is mediation. But what is online mediation? Online mediation is nothing but the mediation is being conducted in the online platform. It may be entirely online or it can be partially online. It does not mean it should be only online. Okay, this is some people have that notion that it should be conducted only online, then only it will be called as online mediation. No, it can also have a combination or a hybrid of having in-person mediation and online mediation. Okay, let's take a walk back to how this online mediation came up. Okay, from the year we are now only looking into the online mediation, and mostly we are pressurized because of the COVID. But one of the advantages of COVID, online mediations. But if you look at the world for online mediation, online mediations have started way back, even in late 80s. The first form of online mediation was blind bidding, wherein it was basically a commercial dispute, wherein the parties who are in dispute with e-commerce or online purchase or something, they would blindly offer their request for their dispute, saying that these are their disputes, and then the other side party, the supplier or the manufacturer, he will just give a set of like FAQs, he will give possible solutions, and those possible solutions will be considered by the customer who is being distressed. And if they accept those solutions, they can go ahead, or otherwise, they will go through another process of again putting up the negotiation. And literally, one person bidding something, and the other person bidding another amount, and there will be a neutrally, the technology will fix the center. Neutral place wherein they can meet together and resolve their dispute. This is what was the first stage of online mediation. Okay. Then because of the technology and the development of the commerce and industry, there was a lot of pressure for bringing in more online mediation. Right. And the Ansaltral made it very specific that all the countries should go in for an online dispute resolution forum. So those countries which were signatories of the online signatories of the International Trade and Commerce, they were asked to bring in laws for online dispute resolution and information technology and other relevant acts. So that is why we have the Information Technology Act, and then very soon we will also have the Mediation Act. Then the next step of the online mediation was that after filling up the forms and giving a tick mark and all those kind of resolving disputes, then came a facilitated method of settlement wherein a third party was appointed, and the third party will be sent a mail or a message saying this is their problem and this is what they expect from as a resolution from the other party. And that mail will be given to the other party, and other party will respond to it. There was a third party who was a neutral who would facilitate the negotiation. But this was also not very well taken. But one company called Trade Square, that was very, very eminent. And they were doing in 1999 until 2008. They were just doing a lot of mediations online. eBay was preferring only this Trade Square. So they will resolve their disputes through Trade Square, wherein the customer who has a problem, they will send their request. These are the problems. And these are the three options which I would like to resolve by which. And they will also give a specific description of the problem. And that will be viewed by the other party, sent to the other party, and the other party will give the resolution, whatever he thinks is the best. And they can take it or leave it. It's only a matter of taking it or leaving it. Otherwise, they can go for another dispute to the regular litigation dispute. Then there was another form of online dispute is that mailing through emails that was being done. both parties will send a mail, and the mail will be transferred to the another party, and the reply also will be exchanged. In that case also, there was no direct link, right? So there was a need for direct interaction. And because of the development of technology, there we started using the technology for that. The first form was like the Skype that we used. Most of the Apple users would have used the Skype to communicate with their family members or dear ones in a platform wherein they can meet and talk to them virtually. So that was for some time used as a method to resolve the dispute. And then there was another that developed a little more, and a lot of companies came in and giving in more technology for and development wherein they can use this platform for resolving dispute in a beautiful way, including a private rooms and all those things. As you know, in a mediation, we always do a mediation in a joint session and a private session also. So technology today provides a main session like this main hall, which meeting hall, which we all share now, and a private rooms for these private discussions, which enables the parties to have more privacy and confidentiality. Okay, so why do we need to do an online mediation? What is the necessity to do an online mediation? Not just the corona has made us to take up to online mediation. There are so many other reasons why we need an online mediation or a virtual mediation. In an online mediation, the time and the travel, the cost, everything can be reduced. See, the parties to participate in a mediation, they need not travel long hours and come to the mediation center and wait for their turn. And sitting in front of the other party, getting very much agitated, also brings in more agony to the parties. So they get very desperate. Okay, so those things can be avoided. The cost, travel, time, everything can be reduced. And then another important thing is the technology has made people to feel that they are very close to each other. We may be miles apart, staying in our own convenient home or office and participate in this meeting. But the same way in mediation also, people can sit in their at ease in their home or office and do the mediation. And when they are in their home or office, they can always refer to their immediately consult their people around them and get their guidance and get things done. So this is how there are a lot of benefits. This is the major benefit that happens. How do we make online mediation a better platform for the participants and for the development of mediation? That is the important question. As mediator, the first thing first, we need to learn the technology first. Yeah? The technology, we need to master the technology first. Unless you know the technology, you will not be able to handle the technology. The technology, normally in a mediation, there are three parties, right? The party A, party B, and the mediator. But when the online mediation, it becomes the fourth party mediation. The device and the internet becomes the fourth party. And you need to understand the fourth party and handle the fourth party wisely. Okay. So understanding the technology is a must. Then moving on to the next important aspect is that for understanding the technology, you need to understand your position, your device properly. If you don't know which button you have to touch, where is the button, you don't even know where to stop, where to start. Right? For an example, to say in one of my online mediation trainings, my colleague who was trying to teach the or a senior mediator just to switch on the microphone and switch off the microphone. Okay. Here we use the word mute and unmute. So that's a new word for our dictionary people who normally we don't use, say, mute yourself. We just say switch off, switch on. So that is the thing. And for the person, senior person who wanted to know like how to switch on and switch off the microphone, it took for him around over half an hour, and still he couldn't figure out how to tell him. Then he just told me, Kavita, just try and explain to him. No, maybe he will understand if you say. Then I had a chance of saying, I just told him, sir, did you take your medicines in the morning? He said, yes, I took one green medicine, one capsule, and red capsule, and some four or five tablets. I said, sir, that green capsule you took, no, the same capsule is there in the bottom of your screen. If you see, that is the first one. Yes, ma'am, I saw that it is going up and down. Yes, that is the microphone. It is the same button. If you click, you can switch it on. The same button you click it, you switch it off. It is the simple. See, when you teach technology, you need to get down to the floor, to the level of the participant, of their understanding, understand the participants, and teach them. If you teach them for lifetime, he will never forget that. So he will always remember whenever he switches on the online program, he knows that there is a microphone there. He needs to switch on and switch off, right? So similar way, understanding the technology and imparting the technology is also important. As a mediator, why should I impart? I'm not a trainer, but why should I impart that to others? Yes, we need to know that, because in an online mediation, the participants may not be aware of the technology. Or they may be aware of the technology, but not updated of about it. Okay, we need to help the parties understand the technology and use it wisely. And in the present day scenario, people are making wonderful videos without any assistance or training or any diplomas or degree from film institutes. You can see so many TikTok videos or other videos that is coming up, circulated everywhere. The laymen, common laymen, are taking all those videos. So we cannot underestimate that they will not know the technology. They know the technology. They are using the technology, but for other matters. But they need to use the same technology for resolving their own dispute. Then coming to online method of online dispute resolution. Evolving from the telegram and telephone conversation to emails, then moving on to this virtual mode, then we are just on the verge of stepping into the another popular mode of teleportance. Teleportation or holography is the next stage of mediation. It will come up very soon, because already we are seeing so many interviews. The first interview with the President Barack Obama and Oprah Winfrey, that was used the technology of the green screen background. And holography is another technology wherein the 3D dimensional image is being morphed and again placed in the other person's video. So it's coming. The next technology is that. So the little difficulty, whatever it is there in the online mediation today, we will overcome that also when the people will feel and see the entire person standing in a life size before them, right? So these advantages and necessities, we have to keep ourselves updated. Okay, what are the three important things that feature in mediations, online mediations? That is confidentiality, right? There are so many of you who have completed the 9 classes from the excellent masters of all over India. Can anyone of you unmute yourself and tell me what do you mean by confidentiality?
Madam, in the mean of confidentiality means it should be knowing between only the parties.
Sir, please switch on your videos when you talk. Would you mind switching on your videos?
Yes, madam.
Yes, sir.
See, confidentiality in the sense it will be, the matter should be in between only two parties. It never goes to other party. Only two, between only two parties. Then it will...
Okay. I think we have lost it. Only two parties. Okay.
Yeah.
What about the mediator? Mediator does not...
No, mediator is a... mediator will act... So he's a neutral person. No, mediator is a neutral person. He should be in between the two parties only.
In between the two parties, fine.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Confidentiality. How do you think we can maintain the confidentiality in mediation? Online mediation. Is it possible?
Maybe the possibility is very, very low level, madam, because online means it will be disclosing two parties, no? So it is, whatever the matter in between the parties, it will be reflecting to the both the parties.
Okay. Fine. Thank you for that answer. Before we get into the details of confidentiality, thank you, sir. The confidentiality, we need to have a deeper understanding about confidentiality, the privacy, secrecy, security. These are different things, okay? It's not the same. Confidentiality is the information, the data is the information that is being shared between a particular group of people. See, in a mediation, it is if the parties in a joint session, they share some information and that is between all the parties there. If they are going to share it in a private mediation, a private session, then it will be shared only with the mediator and that party. It will not be even be shared to the other party. And the mediator will maintain the confidentiality and he or she will not disclose it to the other party. Okay, that is confidentiality. Then coming to privacy, the privacy is a very peculiar aspect. The thing is, the party or anybody who needs to keep certain data for themselves. I decide this is for me. Okay, this is about me and this is me and I need my privacy. This is my right to be alone, left alone is privacy. Okay. Privacy refers to the person. And next is the secrecy. Secrecy is that certain aspect which I don't want to reveal to somebody. I just want to keep it concealed with only me or with only the mediator. Keep it secret. Madam, please do not tell this to other person. I still like to resolve this by this way, but still it is not ripe enough. Now, don't tell to the other party. That is a secret, or that there is a secret information that is within the party which he is not divulging it. He or she is not divulging it. The secrecy is the thing. For instance, somebody has done nowadays online classes, you know, everybody. Most of the students in their online classes, they are scoring hundreds. Normally in their in-person classrooms, they will not even secure 40%, but they are scoring 100%. If allowed, they will be also given 110%. How is that possible? But can anybody say, what did you do in your last exam? There you find the answer for the secrecy. Everybody want to keep it secret. They don't want to say what they did. Okay. So that is secrecy. What I did, I don't want to reveal it to the others. Security. The security is another aspect wherein it says the information that is given to me in private as a mediator, I need to keep that information or data secure without being infringed or even eavesdropping should not be done. It should not be heard or infringed or in any manner by any other party except the person who had divulged to me and the person who listens to it. I maintain it as security. Okay. even the Information Technology Act, you see, provides the security only for the data that are kept in a secure environment, secure computer or device. If it is not a control with a password or any other thing, virus is being manipulated or there is some worm there, all those things, he cannot go complain because there is no protection. There is no password. It is not kept in a secured environment. All these things have to be kept in a secured environment. I had sent a word through the coordinators here for this EMW session, that throughout the session, I requested everybody to keep their videos on, particularly the students to keep their videos on. But I don't see, most of them are switching on and off their videos. See, this being an educational session, this is not a webinar, I think. If I'm wrong, please correct me. When you are in an educational session or a training session, we need to keep our videos on all the time. It is very, very important. That is why we send a word saying that please stay indoors, use your computer or a laptop, not your mobile devices, so that we can just talk a little more longer and clearer. Yeah. So I hope you have understood the difference between confidentiality, privacy, security, and secrecy. Okay. So anybody needs a clarification on that? Yeah. Okay. Next, moving to the next part of training is that, after this confidence, maintaining this confidence, one of the biggest aspect is that when we are doing mediation for people who are in the IT field or who are in the industry or somebody wherein who has some knowledge about online or thing, there will be a lot of protest saying there is no security or confidentiality in the online media. No, it is not so. See, there is always a tracking whether you use the online or not, because almost all of us have a mobile phone, and that too not an ordinary phone. It's an Android smartphone, okay, an Apple phone, wherein that phone connects us to the internet 24/7, 365 days. Even when you just switch off the screen, your camera, your video, voice, everything is on. It is watching you. It is listening to you. Nothing is confidential. If your Google map is on, the Google knows where you are moving about. Some of the app requests that your map, they should give you permission to use your video, microphone, and then cameras, gallery, and all those things. Unless you give them permission, they will not allow you to use the app. So when you give those permission, everything is there online. Even if you keep your phone next to you and talk something, everything reflects online. But what is the use? On the internet, people, what they do is that they keep tracking the marketing words. Those words, if you say some marketing words like travel, budget, I want to go this place, I want to do this thing, so you will get advertisements based on those things. That is how they market and get us into trap. Okay. When you are doing a mediation, and particularly most of the platforms which are provided now have a very secure platform. So their conversation are not being recorded even by the mediators. So it is almost safe, right? If there are keywords, they are likely to be taken by the parties, marketing people, and they will send only marketing things. Nothing else can be done from that, right? Already people will be exploiting the resources only. not disputes. Nobody will be interested in disputes. When there is a dispute in a property, people will not be interested in a disputed property and to explore those things. So that is, people literally ignore that property. Okay, so everything, where when there is a dispute, people will ignore that. So we don't have to worry about it. Nobody is going to watch every word of what we say. So we need to instill this confidence on the participants so that the participants can say that, okay, I'm confident to do our mediations discussions in the online platform. See, if you do not believe your WhatsApp video calling or your any video calling, right, then it is acceptable. But when you are regularly doing a video calling with your mobile phones or your device, other devices, it is similarly the same way. So there you, at one place you say you don't accept and one place you say you really accept. It is really a tangent. So we need to take one stand saying that this is really good for the, at least for the progress or at least for the resolution of the dispute. Okay. Next, how do we convene this mediation? Initially, when the mediation, if it is an quote and expo mediation program, mostly the parties' contact details are given to us, and then we just contact the parties and do a pre-discussion, pre-mediation discussions. That is very, very important. The pre-mediation discussions, the parties will be informed that what are the technology that they need to have. They need the devices, at least a phone, at least a laptop or a PC, whatever they have, they that must be accessible to them. And that they might also need a good internet. Yeah, all those preconditions will be informed in the pre-discussions and their consent will be obtained there. And then the preferable dates for mediations will be fixed. And the SOPs, whatever it is, will be forwarded to them. It might differ from state to state between court and ex mediations because these mediations, the court gives us instructions for the, in those high courts. So each state, they follow a different setup, but mostly it is similar. Okay, after convening the meeting, important aspects, those things which we need to get things done is that, first is the convening of the meeting. Say when we are going to do it, schedule a meeting, get people there, assemble them there, and then conduct the meeting. That is what we are going to do. And this part goes, makes us to the next level of setting an atmosphere. Okay, what is setting of atmosphere? In any case, we need to make the parties comfortable and presentable for discussions. Okay. We are all here. I asked all of you to switch on your videos. Most of you have not done, your videos are not on, unfortunately. And those students who have your videos on, just look at your frame and just tell me, how does it look? Yeah. The image which you show conveys what you are. How much importance you give to this event on the mediation. Okay. The first point of setting an atmosphere is the positioning of your frame. Okay. Positioning of your frame. Your picture in the frame, in the video, how should it should be? It should be in the center. Shubhangi has got her video well. Yeah, that's really a nice smile. You can carry it all along.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
The thing is, like, your lighting, the light should be in front of you, not behind you. Most of you have your lights behind you. Okay, just face the light and sit. So that will be a good thing. And never put your device below your chest. The level should be at the level of your chest, or when you're seated position, it should be at the level of your, where you can put your keyboard or your hands there. not below that. Yeah. Yeah. I just don't want to do this every time, right? Yeah, this is. This conveys a lot of meaning, right? These are the non-verbal communications. Yeah, we are doing a professional event, but still, we have so many headaches here. So we don't just can't hold our head up and then talk. We need a support. How much professionalism is that? Online mediation is much more professional than the regular mediation. You need to project yourself more professional, right? Yeah, the party should not be distracted even by a single image behind you. The fan running behind George, right? Or the bookcase behind the other person, I just can't get his name fully, right? So that is also is not right. If we are going to distract the parties, they will be looking at the things behind and being inquisitive, right? And we love to have our own way of dressing up presenting ourselves. But that's really good. But that should never distract the other person who is looking at us, right? Suppose we don't have a formal or a professional background or the atmosphere at home. You can always use a virtual background. Yeah. And the important aspect is that, have you ever seen Thangachan just leaning forward to you like this? You had never seen. You can never see. Thangachan will always sit erect, right? I really appreciate that. Whenever you see him online, he will always sit upright. He will not go before the camera. It is very important we don't go near the camera and frighten the people who are watching us. The more you go near the camera, the bigger your features are and the more scarier it is. Okay, so we need to adjust all that. You can do all this pre-setting even before the meeting starts. Go to your virtual background or your camera, switch on the your videos and see how you are positioned, what it is, and adjust all this accordingly. And then you can just start the meeting, join the meeting. You don't have to jump in and join the meeting. Okay? So be very, very, very professional every time you appear on an online mediation. That is very, very important. The impression that you create in the minds of the participants will get you their trust and rapport. Build up the rapport. Unless they have confidence in you, they are not going to open up the discussion, and there's going to be very little the discussion and rapport building will not happen. Right? And we will not end up in a resolution. So we need to be very careful about how we present ourselves. Okay, even in a virtual training or a classroom like this, we need to exhibit ourselves more professionally. That is very, very important. Okay, then the next thing which we have to do is that teach the parties what are the necessary buttons that they need to use and how they have to use. For instance, you can tell them you can keep your microphone switched off when you're not talking and switch on when you're talking. Because in a normal space in person, we are always used to just open our mouth and talk. We don't need a button to switch on and then talk. But in virtual space, when we get ourselves so much involved, we forget sometimes our microphones are switched off. Somebody will just keep shouting and saying that, please, your microphone is saying you're muted. Please, ma'am, please, right? Okay, then suddenly you'll just realize after the being carried away, okay, my microphone is switched off. I'll just switch it on. That important. And one more important aspect which we need to remember is that never put your hand never put your hand before your face, before your camera. Right? If you want, somebody has messaged, Zoom meet means not zooming our face. Yeah. Hare Krishna. The thing is, when we switch on and switch off your microphone, it is very, very important because the continuity will go off, right? The parties will lose their continuity. See, suppose they are saying, so they were just reporting you something, some incident that was happening and all those things. Suddenly, everything blacks off. And again, when they start, no, they won't know where they stopped. So they will have to start it from the beginning. Again, they'll give you another version of the same story. Right? You will be hearing all the while. But they wouldn't have realized that. Okay. And the hands, with respect to the hands, I was just telling, in case you are using your smartphones, we were telling you please to avoid using smartphones for the training or a mediation, because those buttons are there in the phone. When you just put your hands to enhance or change the mode or switch on your microphone or whatever it is, your hands go right above. So it is like putting your hand in somebody else's face. That is not etiquette. Okay. So we should not raise our hands. See, I'm so much used to, in physical mediation, I'm so much used to move my hands and talk. But in online mediation, I'm not able to do that. That is a restriction that we need to learn to overcome. See, I can raise my hands up to my ears, not above this. Right? That is not manners. This is the level I can take. Not above my ears. Okay. So we have our own space restriction here. Within that space, we have to do the best things we can do. Okay. And the next issue of which I really wanted, like I was seeing all your the past 9 videos of the EMW, how the training was all conducted, because this is being an online thing, I need to get it refreshed. Say what are the things that has to be changed and for the better and all these things. So that was why these things I found that we need to learn from our past experience. That is what is that. And next, after getting the people, everything, the technology, everything in place, we need to start the mediation. How do you start the mediation? Nikita? Nikita, can you tell us how do you start a mediation?
Yes, ma'am. You start by, the mediator has
to... Can you be a little louder?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, feebly.
Yeah, so I was saying that the mediator has to convey to the parties how the entire process will go about.
Not audible, Nikita.
Your network connection is not proper.
No, you need.
Is it fine now?
Yeah. The next aspect is that you need to have a microphone, mic, and a headset. Because you're using your device without a headset or a microphone, when you speak, the voice scatters. You're sitting in a corner of a room, right? And the room is quite big. Your voice echoes.
Am I audible now?
You just put your headset. It'll be more audible. Okay. Anybody else would like to try that? Asha? Would you like to?
Ma'am,
how do you like to start your mediation?
Making them comfortable.
Then?
Okay, ma'am, let me think. Can you give me some time?
Yeah, take your time. The whole world is yours.
And may I?
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Yes, yes, come on.
I think that we should start mediation by listening to both the sides of the party, know the scenario, the issues mainly that need mediation.
Yeah, wonderful.
That need to be mediated.
Wonderful, but I need a step little earlier than that. I was just talking about a little step before that. Yes, Nikita, you can just try.
First, we have to take an introduction of the both the parties, madam. When we are sitting in face to face, again, we have to take an introduction. Then we have to know what is the problem in between the parties. Then we have to give a solution for an amicable settlement for the both the parties.
Yes, that's right, sir. First, initially, there has to be an introduction and then an opening statement. Okay. There are two aspects that are very different. Introduction is saying who I am, right? An opening statement is that what is being done in the process. Okay. Opening statement about what it is, how it is being done. All that opening statement in mediation sessions, you have already heard about it. What is mediation? How it is being done? Benefits of mediations, advantages of mediations. Now, all these things that is in will be in the opening statement, the process of mediation. But introduction. Here in person mediation, you know the staff or the people around you, whoever brings them to your mediation, will tell us this is so and so, and they are the parties here, and you make them sit and do it. But in an online, we don't know who that person is. Okay? Somebody can impersonate. So how do we overcome that? So when we have a lawyer or a person, we have a pre-discussion. In that pre-discussion, they prove themselves, they are so and so. So we come to know this is the person who is appearing for the online mediation. So this introduction will help you once again, the other party also to recognize that this person is the so-called party A, right? Suppose the party A is Geetanjali. Geetanjali will just say, I am Geetanjali. I am an advocate, mediator, trainer. I am here, so and so. So that is the way that she will introduce herself, right? It is always preferable to have a lawyer there. So when an online mediation, the lawyer has the first introduction. They will say, I am the lawyer of party A. And the party A is here, and he will point out to that person and I'll say, she will talk now. And that party A, his party will say, yes, sir, I'm talking. I'm party A. I'm just doing the, I'm here. I'm come for this mediation and I'm from this place. Whatever introduction they are giving about themselves, they will give. Okay. The same way the party B, the advocate of the party B will also give his or her introduction, then introduce his party, and his party will talk about herself or himself. Okay, so we identify the parties correctly. It is very important to identify the parties and then move to the next stage. After identifying the parties, then you give the opening statement. The mediator gives an opening statement. At the last, first it will go to the advocate or the party will do the opening statement saying what is their cases, what are the things and everything in a very brief note, whether they are the petitioner or a plaintiff, defendant, whatever it is. All those descriptions will be given in a very, very, very brief note, and then the mediator, it comes to the mediator. The mediator in the opening statement will give all the facts about mediation, including the benefits and, as I said, the advantage, disadvantage, everything. Including the process of mediation. Very, very important. You need to tell them, this is how the mediation will be conducted. So without that, they will be thinking it is either a panchayat or just a discussion or a court annex program wherein the mediator will be giving orders or something or delivering an award. So all those things will be clarified there. Okay, so that opening statement gives a lot of build-up rapport between the party and the mediators. The confidentiality building up actually starts with opening statement. Okay. So after the opening statement, then we'll tell them go for the joint session. Okay. Now we will be doing this. Then how will you, what is the most preferred way of just saying the party A will start the discussion? How will you just ask? Can anyone say? George, would you like to say?
Could you just repeat that once?
How will you ask, initiate the first joint session?
I'm not sure, ma'am.
Anybody else want to try?
May I?
Yes.
You can ask one of the parties. For example, we have party A and party B. We can ask party A, would they like to start? Just as a question.
Start what?
Would they like to put forth their stance?
See, this is not code to put their stand.
Ma'am, not stand, stance. I mean,
yeah, what they would like to say, stance. What, right, even there. Yeah. What, any other better way of putting it? Nikita, you're trying to tell us something, but we don't know actually what you're trying to say.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Very, very low, Nikita.
You could just write it in the chat box.
Yeah. Or you can come a bit closer to your device. Yeah, that will be, I think, more.
You're still not audible. I think you just write it in the chat box. I would convey it to her, whatever you want.
Yeah. Right. Let's not waste time. We'll take some more thing. The thing is, it will be always easy. The mediation has evolved itself in using and choosing the words which we use for mediation. Instead of saying this, can you just tell me your, tell us about your dispute? Tell us about your, what you want to resolve here, right? You can tell them like, can you share us about your concerns? Right? Can we just talk about it? Would you like to say something about it? Instead of using the word dispute or the disagreement or the all those words which say negative impressions, we can just say a neutral word, your concerns, right? So if you put that word there, it makes a lot of things. See, even a small conjunction may make a big difference, right? Instead of saying but, you can use and. It makes a lot of difference with the parties, right? But you could have done this, right? Instead of saying that, and you can add this. Can you add this? It would make a much difference. So that way we can, the conversation has to be more polite, more clearly explained. Okay. In a normal way of speech, we will be very, very fast in compared to the way we speak in online. When you're delivering something in an online platform, you need to keep your words nicely paced with a lot of gaps, and your tone has to come down. If you're going to raise your pitch, it will echo in manifold. So you're going to hurt somebody's ears. So naturally what they will do is they'll stop hearing, they'll shut it down. They don't want to hear. Okay, so you need to keep, if you want people to listen to you, you need to keep your volume very low in an audible position and your tone very, very acceptable tone, and you need to pace your words. Okay, so that is also important. And you, every time you give some gap for the parties to respond, because the technology takes some time, even though it is a nanosecond, it takes time to transmit. When I say something, the same second, it does not reach you. It takes at least a fraction of a nanosecond to reach you. So if I'm going to say you a lot of words very quickly, you may not know anything. Okay, it might sound like supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, right? That was just one word. Just one word. That's the longest word. Once upon a time, a longest word in English, but that will not. You will not be able to hear it or understand what I said. So we need to pace. Another aspect in online mediation is that after we talk everything, we have to keep them informed every step. If you're going to say, I'm going to mute yourself. If somebody is going to talk at the pitch of their voice or they are very angry, you are telling them, please keep calm down and all those things. Still, they are not doing. But no other way, you're being the host, you're going to mute them, right? But you have to do it politely, telling them, informing them that you're going to mute them. So they have to keep themselves cool. Okay, whatever you do, you have to inform and then do. See, then you're going to a private session, the breakout rooms. The breakout rooms is a private room in a meeting where you can manually or automatically assign parties. Mostly in mediation, we do it manually so that we can assign whoever we want to one particular room. In that way, in the private session, also, you need to tell the parties, I'm going to create a private room. So-and-so will be in the private room. And you will have so much time for you to discuss in the private room. And you, all your discussions you can do. And I will come in. You have to tell them you will be coming there. You can't just barge in there as a mediator. You don't have all the rights to just barge in into somebody's private conversation and just say, hey, I'm the mediator. I can do that. No. You tell them you will be there in a minute or so. Then you create the rooms and tell them the rooms have been created. Now the rooms will be open. Please join the room. Then they will join the room. Just wait until everybody joins the room. And the participants, whoever left in the main meeting hall, inform them that you are going to go to the private room and talk to them, have a chat there, and come back in just few minutes. In the meantime, give them some work. In the main hall, because they can have a discussion with their client or parties can have some discussions. All those things can happen. I'll come back in a few seconds, few minutes. Then you inform them, leave that place, go to the breakout room. And from in the breakout, before going to the breakout room also, you can send a message to them, right? In that message, then you can go inside, like knocking the door and entering the room. You enter that room and then you have a discussion. And when you finish the discussion, you want to leave the room. You tell them, like, I'm be leaving. You have another 2 more minutes. You can just come back after that. Okay. Then you leave the room. Every time you do it, informing them only. You can't just take, even though they know the technology, you can't take things granted. You have to be very polite. Guide them, take them along with you. That is how it will go. Then they have gone to this back and forth. You are doing them online mediation, private and joint mediation discussions are over. Suddenly somebody says like they want to disclose a document or some invoice paper or something that they have an evidence, right? That is, they want to show it to the other party that the consignment has changed or something has done, whatever it is. We can do it in the share screen, but we have to get the consent of both the parties saying that such and such a thing document is there with this party. He is willing to share with you. Are you willing to go through the document online? Because there is all possibility that document will be recorded or downloaded online. Okay, there is. Even before you start in the SOP, which you are talking about in the opening statement and everything, you have to inform the people more particularly. Online mediation will not be recorded by the mediator, and it should not be recorded by the parties, because being it very confidential. Okay, so in that case, the parties here also, when they are there, they are not supposed to record it through directly from the device which they are using or through any other device in audio or video. That is prohibited. In case they do that, we can always tell them you are breaking the confidentiality. And in case they are sharing the document, but the person who wants to share the document must also know that there is a possibility of all these things. Is he willing to share knowing this, all these things that are to happen? Yes, if he says yes, then he can share. And even then, the mediator has to say without prejudice. Without prejudice means, in case if the mediation fails, those documents that has been shared in the online shall not be used against the person who has shared the document. Okay, that is a without prejudice rule. So without prejudice, the document will be shared. Okay, they can even write it down and do the same thing. Whatever, even the whiteboard that they are using, the discussions that they are pointing, writing down the issues and all those things, that also they have to do it without prejudice note. Okay, then the next aspect is that after sharing the thing, they are negotiating, they are arriving at a settlement, but still they have something just waiting behind. You have to give them some time to go back and consult with their people, with their lawyers or relatives or friends, because culturally we are all so connected and so dependent that we don't even take any decision for ourselves so quickly. Okay. In our homes, if you see, your mom would have cooked the food and she would have prepared the table and everything done. And then she will come and ask you, would you like to have food? She can just come and say, just come on, come have food. Right? But still, she, would you like to come and have your food? And then she would have prepared a list of things, but still she would just ask you, what would you like to have? What would you like to have? Then she would have made some idlis. Then you will ask, no, can I have dosas? Can I have chapatis? Again, she'll go and make that and bring it to you. If she is free, she will do it. Otherwise, she'll tell you, I have already made this. Why don't you, would you try this or do you really want that? The similar manner, you need to tell the parties, these are the options available. Would you like to take it? Or would you like to go for the other alternative? So keep them informed. Their informed consent is very, very important throughout the process. Okay, they have successfully resolved their issues and finally comes to the agreement. Coming to the agreement, okay, agreement, they have to write the agreement. How will they write the agreement? They can do it. They have always have a choice of doing it online. There are a lot of online platforms where you can write a document online. But normally, we would not suggest that to use Google Docs in an online platform. Privately, if you're not in sharing in an online, you can use Google Docs, but not in an online platform. That is not mostly recommended because that document will appear in your Google Docs. And anytime it can be accessed by others also. So keeping that document very confidential and private. So we have to get things done. Take up a Word document in your one of them can choose to be the person to write the document, type out the document. You can share screen, write the agreement, right? And take the draft and send an email to them. Your creative minds have so many options of getting it done. Then finally, you can exchange emails and then finally arrive at the draft agreement through your councils. And then the parties understand the agreement. You exclusively allot one session for making sure the parties understand the agreement. Okay, it is very, very important. Some of the parties might not understand what is in the agreement, just blindly believing that everything what has been written is correct. Whatever they have agreed is there. they will, in a rush, they will accept. But if you see, there might be certain things that have been inserted. So there are certain things which they don't understand. We need to devote one session with them, so making sure that they understand the entire agreement. Okay, and so that they also comply with the agreement. Okay. See, if they are going to agree on principle and with their hearts, they will definitely enforce it. We don't need a separate mechanism to enforce it. If they don't have a confidence, if they don't want to do it, definitely if they sign all the agreement also, they are not going to do it. The mediator will know that whether they are really agreeable or simply they are just for the sake of writing an agreement, they are doing it. So in the reality check session, we will know what is the position of the parties. So when you once again do it in the final agreement stage also, if there is something contradictory going on, you can recognize that and bring it forward. And once again, you can initiate it and clarify the discussions. Okay. So finally, the agreement is being done. It has to be signed. Either it can be physically signed, or what are the other ways? Can anybody say?
I think, ma'am, you can possibly scan your signature and upload it.
As JPJ?
I think, ma'am, as a PDF document as well.
You have to take the digital signature, ma'am.
See, I have only one litigation. Right. And that for one litigation, if I'm going to go and get a digital certified signature, I'm going to spend another 5 to 10,000 rupees to, and it will take 15 days for me to get the digital signature. Yes? How do we do that? Yes, Nikita, you want to say something? You're typing it down. That's really good. So you can either ask them physically, go take the printouts and sign the documents and exchange it and sign it and bring it to the center or wherever you are. And there is another way of online doing it. In online method, there is an electronic signatures, that is e-signatures, and there is digital signatures. Like George said, undertaking that their names is sufficient to act as the signature. Yeah, that is good, like your email. In your email, you can put your signatures there. Yeah, there is I don't know how many of you are using that technology. You can write your name or signature in your email, which comes in all your mails. Okay. That's what Nikita is also trying to say. That is electronic signatures and digital signatures, that has been detailedly explained in the Information Technology Act. And there is also a rules for that. See, electronic signatures, these two types of signatures are acceptable in online platform. Both have equal credits. What is, as per the Information Technology Act, what is important, the aspects that are to be concerned is that the signature should be of the person who intends to sign, right? He should accept that is his signature. So the same other person also accepts it to be the true signature of that person. It is not manipulated, okay? And it is actually signed by that person. And he does not refute it, saying, no, I did not sign it. Somebody else has signed it. This is not my signature. No, that should not be the case. See, now, because of the technology, we have a lot of platforms, apps like DocuSign, PDF Sign, all that, Nitro Sign. You can get a trial version of that for 7 days. For one signature or two signatures, you don't have to buy. If the mediator or the advocate sends the document through, marks the place where the parties have to sign and send it by mail, the document to the other person. The other person will receive the document. then he will open the document. When the document is open, the PDF will, the file will say like, this document is signature enabled. So you can sign the place which you are supposed to sign. And with there'll be an option of writing your name or using your mouse or cursor or pen to write your, actually digitally write it. Those options will be there. You can put it there, then shrink the signature and put it exactly between those lines and your name, and then present it and send it through the email to the other party. When the other party receives it, then they will get, if they check it, they will get the certification from the company saying that such and such person has signed the document from this email at this time. This is their geo positioning place. And this was the time and this is the thing. And now the with a pro version, you can even get the impression that was created, at what pressure it was done, or it was just scribbled or something like that. All those things, readings can also be taken up nowadays. But in a general normal trial version, you can get it geo positioning and certification of the person who signed it. So that is well and good. That is also an accepted form. Now the signature is there. Both the parties and their councils have signed. Then the both the parties can take a printout of the same and get it. It is also another methodology is the QR code. See, normally if you take your birth certificates or your any government certificates which you get, like your FMB field map book or encumbrance certificate, from the registration department. If you check online, you'll have a QR code. Okay. If you click that QR code, the signature of the person who signed the document will be verified and inform that there will be a window popping up telling us this signature is genuine. This signature does not match if it is being manipulated. Right? If you are going to take a printout of this and somebody is going to manipulate some of the data of that document, if you are going to present it into some for an interview or a job or some placement, they can code that, they can scan that QR code and check the entire data. If you have changed some data there, the QR code will show the actual data what was printed there. So manipulation can always be checked, but it takes little more effort. If you are prepared to put little more effort, then we can do it very beautifully. Okay, we have concluded our starting of the mediation and completing it with an agreement. How many more minutes do I have, Thangachan sir?
Yes. Sure.
How many more minutes, sir?
Now it is 6:22. We can have 5 more minutes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Can we have questions on these time? People who.
That also, I think we can.
Madam, good evening. I am Rangnath here. Madam, in the giant section, in the offline classes, the parties can we can create the private room, as you said. But how we can create the private sections in the online classes, online mediation, madam?
Sir, online mediation, sir, C.T. Ranganathan, sir, would you mind to switch on your video?
Yes.
The platform. Now, Thangachan, sir, is using Zoom. Yeah. Zoom has a provision of breakout rooms. There is a room within the main meeting hall. You can create those breakout rooms or private session in those Zoom platform. Even WebEx has a pro version has a breakout room. So you have a private room wherein you can have a chat there. So you have to understand the technology, learn the technology, then use it.
Thank you.
Hello.
Subhangi, any more questions? Subhangi, please come in.
Yes, sir.
Please coordinate if there are more questions.
Sure. Ma'am, I think Nikita asks, when the confidentiality is broken by either parties by audio recording or screen recording, what kind of consequences are to follow?
First consequence, first fatality will be the mediation. Mediation will conclude the time when they break it. Okay. Next thing we'll follow up is that whatever they have recorded in the online platform, whatever it is, it is and it will fall within the without prejudice rule. So if they're going to take it to court and use it against them, it will become invalid.
Any other question by anybody? I assume no one has any more questions.
Rajesh sir, would you like to ask anything?
Yes, no, madam. Madam, this is Ravichandra. I will ask one question, madam.
Yes, sir.
Please.
Actually, in mediation, we have to maintain the secrecy. That is called a confidentiality. But in online resolution point, how much of confidentiality we can able to expand the confidentiality in that extent, madam?
Sir,
is it possible to maintain the secrecy certain extent?
Sir, it is the same as you talk to your distant relative or your friend or your brother or sister who is living abroad. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
When you talk to them with the video conferencing, is your confidentiality, privacy, secrecy being disturbed? Do you get...
Because in a resolution system, because we are concentrating on a dispute, so while conversation in between me and others in a safer mode, it's not at all a problem, madam. Because here
same mode yeah. You are using, sir. You are using the same Skype, same Zoom, okay. Same WebEx, same okay. WhatsApp, the same platform you are using.
Okay, madam.
So the same the platform is the same. When you are talking to your friends, you say it is safe. When you are talking to the parties, you say it is not safe.
Okay, madam.
It is only in our own mental setup that we think it is not safe.
Okay, right? Okay.
It is the same effort we have to put in to build up the confidence of the parties.
Okay, madam.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam.
Madam, again, I have one more question, madam, here.
Sir.
See, madam, now as a recording point of the view, see, there is a rule, either the party or mediator should not be record the section, okay? So after completion of the mediation and the agreement is also signed by both the parties, and then the mediator has recorded, they came to know the parties, the section has recorded by the mediator. So what will be the consequences on that mediation, madam?
Normally, mediators will not record. Okay. Normally, mediators will not record. In case they record, it will not be of any use to them. See, if I'm going to record something, I need more internet, more data storing space. In the device which I am using, I need space to save that. No. So I need more space. If I'm going to do, say, for example, Push Gupta is the mediator. If she is using her laptop to do the mediation, she would have done 1,000 mediations. Okay. If she is going to record at least 100 mediation in her laptop, will she be able to do that? And what is the necessity for her to record all that? It is not necessary. Because I am not going to pass any orders. I don't have to remember anything what I do in the mediation. Except few notes which I have in my paper, that also will be destroyed at the end of the session. Okay. So if I'm going to pass orders, I'm going to remember everything. I need to keep everything safe. So I record it. That is why the court is always asking us for copies, always asking us for the documents. Here, we don't need that. We don't have to remember anything. As a mediator, it is not my duty to remember that. I'm just only a facilitator, right? I'm just the fly on the wall. I'm not even expected to be visible to others. Parties must be able to resolve their disputes on themselves. I must only help them to communicate better and understand each other's perspective. Even if the mediator records it, it will be of no use. It cannot be used against any evidence, as an evidence against any party in any court of law.
Okay. Thank you, Manu. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Nikita, is there any possibility of continuing online mediation process once the confidentiality is broken? If there is an apology or an assurance to refrain from such malpractices? That depends, Nikita, because if the mediator is convinced, it's fine. But if the other party should believe. Just imagine the other party, already they will not have good confidence with the party A. They'll be always doubting party A, saying that even though I accept, he will not accept. Okay, that will be their attitude. But once when somebody makes a mistake in spite of repeated demands or requests, the other party is not going to believe them, right? In exceptional circumstances, if the other party is willing to forgive and continue the mediation, then the mediator can take it with the informed consent. The informed consent is very, very important. With the other party also must consent. Okay, fine. I accept this. We can continue the mediation. Then the mediation can continue.
I would like to ask something.
Yes, sir.
Mediation as a process, I think, is a very much involved with trust and confidence, that you have to put your confidence or trust into the mediator. Now, people generally are of very speculative nature when it comes to online medias and online modes. Like, they are very speculative generally, like it would leak information and all that. Do you think that it is difficult, like rather more difficult than normal offline mediation, to conduct it online, like to gain trust of parties?
Yes, that's a wonderful question. I was just expecting somebody to ask me that. I really appreciate you for asking that. The thing is, in normal mediation itself, it takes a lot of effort to bring in the parties. If both the parties are present in the mediation, the mediator has succeeded in the first part. Push Gupta will accept with me, and all the mediators here will accept with me. If both the parties are present, the first step, the mediators have succeeded. Most of the mediations, we find it is a non-starter because the parties are not coming. Okay. In online mediation, there will definitely be speculations because they don't know the technology, right? They always doubt the technology, right? But it is the part of the mediator, the pre-mediation discussions for the mediator will talk to the parties and instill confidence in them about the online mediation. Tell the parties, see, this is not a problem. See, now we are talking, nobody is going to record this. Nobody is going to use against it. So take confidence, come, let's try it. If it doesn't work, then you can always go back and do your own in-person mediation. Nothing is preventing you from that. Even if you don't want to try in-person mediation, you can go back to litigation. That is not at all a problem. Just give it a try. That is what is required. Okay. So instilling that confidence is the major problem with all the online mediation, because the mediator should be aware of the technology. Mediator should have the patience to talk to the parties and convince them to instill the confidence. If they succeed in that, then online mediation succeeds. because we know the parties are well versed, right? Sometimes in one of my online mediations, I always create a WhatsApp group. After my pre-mediation discussion, I create a WhatsApp group with the parties and counsel. So I will send all the invitation, Zoom invite for the mediations in the WhatsApp group. I don't have to send separate email. Sometimes I think I may be right or wrong, I don't know. I feel if I send a private mail to one person, right? That person other person might feel that I have divulged something to the him or her. So I don't want them to take even one small chance wherein they can doubt my neutrality. So whatever communication I'm doing, I want to do it in a neutral place where both parties can access that communication. So in the group, I will tell them no posting a good morning, good afternoon wishes, no wishes. All you have to do is the Zoom invite will be posted. You have to tell me like you will be coming or not. Is it comfortable? If something goes wrong, you tell me it goes wrong. So because sometimes during mediations, online mediation, either the power or the internet, which is not in our hands, goes off. The parties need to tell us that they are struggling with such and such a thing problem. They might get back to us or they might not be able to get back to us. We have to tune into another session. All these things they have to communicate to us. No, if the party is going to communicate only to the mediator, the other party will be thinking what happened. The mediator and that party is talking privately. They are not informing me. If they are going to put it in the group, so other party will also understand, oh, this is the problem. That is why she's not there or he is not there. So all those important communication is there in the group and the party will get more confidence and the neutrality of the mediator is also maintained. Okay. So that way after the mediation, the group will be deleted. No longer they can access the group. That is one way of communication and maintaining my neutrality.
Thank you, ma'am. So if nobody has any more questions, I would like to hand it over to Rajesh sir again.
Thank you, Subhangi. Thank you, Madam Balakrishnan. In fact, attending the class today, I have learned a lot from you, Madam. I now hand over the proceeding to Madam Push and Thangkachan sir for the concluding remarks.
Kavita ji, truly, Rajesh sir has rightly said, we have learned many good things and the way you have delivered and presented, it was truly student-based. Wonderful connect you had established with students here. It was such light and comfortable presentation. We were learning. I messaged to Thangkachan sir during the presentation. What a wonderful way of conducting a classroom with students. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kavitaji. It's been a wonderful presentation. And last time also, she had a presentation for our Kannur lawyers, I think 2 months back. It's really helpful for the law students in their future studies also. It will be highly useful, I think. So anyway, thank you so much, Kavita ma'am. And
if students, you have any queries on online dispute resolution, you can reach out to Kavita ji.
Definitely.
She would be very happy to receive any queries and help you if you have anything. She's always there.
Yeah. Thank you, Push and Thangkachan sir, for this opportunity. Right, and interact. It was a real pressure interacting with the students. This is what we really love. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rajesh sir. And thank you, Shubhangi.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Bye.